more people coming in. I'm just going to draw some stuff on the board.
Yeah, the blue looks a little better. Maybe.
No, I'm super late.
All right. My name's Andrew Reimers. I'm one of Weber's PhD students, and I'm going to be handling the class today and on Monday and Friday next week. We're talking about Carnot cycles today, and I have not very much information that I need to give you, and then we can get out of here. Sound good? So when we talk about a Carnot cycle, we're specifically referring to a heat engine today. You can also talk about the Carnot cycle with regard to refrigeration or something else, but today we're just going to talk about a heat engine. A heat engine is just a generic name for a device where we're putting heat in, we're trying to get some work out, and then you have to cool it back off to get it to its original state. So the way we talked about this last class was with a diagram kind of like this. We take, can y'all see these colors? These markers are questionable. So we take some heat from a hot reservoir, TH, get some work out, cold reservoir at TC. Another way to think about these, quote, reservoirs, this might be something like a combustor, might be like a fuel rod, or it could even be the sun. Something for this cold sink, this could be anything from ambient air, or it could be some kind of coolant. You could have water, you could have ammonia, you could have one of those weird R things that y'all have got in your textbook. If you think about your car, it's actually a mix of these things. You've got a radiator, and then it's eventually rejecting everything in the atmosphere through the tailpipe. So, using this idea, Carnot created sort of a way of generalizing heat engines. What he said is, okay, let's assume that everything is reversible. Completely reversible. And what we're gonna see is that the efficiency is only a function of the hot temperature and the cold temperature. What we're also going to see is that no other cycle has higher efficiency. So you can think of Carnot as being like the upper limit on the efficiency of a system. So when we talk about a Carnot cycle, there's basically four steps. We're going to draw them on a TS diagram like last class. So essentially, let's say we start here. We are at TC. This is state one. We're going to go from state one to state two using isotropic compression. And I write my S's in cursive because they look like fives if I write them otherwise, so hope that doesn't bother you too much.
No, they just look like A's.
They look like A's, so that's okay. There's nothing wrong with A's. So we're going to compress this isentropically. That's our first state. Then we're going to heat it isothermally. We're going to expand it isentropically. And then we're going to cool it isothermally. So here's our Q out, here's our Q in. Go ahead and write these out. Isotropic compression. Isothermal heating. Isentropic expansion. And then we go back to our original state with some isothermal cooling. So, formulating it like that actually makes it really easy to find the efficiency. How do we find the efficiency of any other cycle? What's the sort of generic way that Dr. Weber has been describing it? Something like sawed over bot. Is that something like what he says? Okay. So normally with the heat engine, what you're talking about is you want work and you're putting some Q in. We figured out last class that that's equal to QH minus QC over QH, which is equal to 1 minus QC over QH. Okay? How do we get this to look like just the hot temperature and just the cold temperature? There's actually a couple different ways to do it. I'll show you the way I like to do it, which I think is kind of easy, and then I'll show you the way Weber wants me to show you to do it, and then learn both, because they're both good. So, something we can say from the second law of thermodynamics is that Q is equal to the integral of T dS. So if we look over here, with that in mind, we can say that QH is equal to TH S3 minus S2. We can also say that QL, or QC, forgive me if I use those interchangeably from different textbooks. That's the state 4. So we'll have S4 minus S1. Plug this into what we had before. Say efficiency is equal to 1 minus TC S4 minus S1 TH S3 minus S2. Now what do we do? This is equal to this, so this goes away. Now you get efficiency is just equal to 1 minus TC over TH. And this is sort of the golden number. You'll need this for your, the FE exam kind of thing, kind of bread and butter engineering equation. I'll show you the way. It's pretty much the same thing. What I showed you is just a variation on the way Dr. Weber wrote it in his notes. It has a really funny name. It's called the Clausius-Clapeyron relation, I think. I'm going to use capital S's now because it uses capital S's, but it doesn't really matter. So what this says is that the change in entropy of a cycle, and this is kind of a simplification, is the hot temperature, or the high temperature heat source over its temperature, the low temperature, I might be writing this backwards. Good, that needs to be minus. Ignore that. Over its temperature plus the generated entropy. We're reversible, so we know that that's zero. So what we end up with here is, if you're saying that there's zero change in entropy for a cycle, that QH over TH is equal to QC over TC, so you get the exact same thing that we had on the other side, TC over TH, because this is zero for a cycle. Does that make sense? So the implication of this is that as we increase the high temperature or decrease the low temperature, we're going to get a higher efficiency. That's something like this. We can do, say that this is our original thing. We do something like this, or something like this. And that'll give us a higher overall efficiency. Up on writing some stuff. Let's look at some examples.
Let's say we have two different heat sources that we're looking at. Let's say that fossil fuel, that's going to be something like 1400 degrees C, 1673K. Nuclear fuel rod, that's more like 700 C, a lot colder. 973K. Let's say our QC is equal to, or our TC is ambient air. So we're going to call that 25 degrees C. Right in there. $298K. So plug those into our efficiencies. Let's say we got efficiency A. 1 minus 298, 1673, and our efficiency of B is going to be 1 minus 298 over 973. And you can already tell this is a smaller number than this. So you're essentially losing less of your efficiency because of this temperature difference, the way this is constructed. So here you get something like 0.82. Here you get something like 0.7. So that's a pretty big difference. And these are Carnot efficiencies. Your real efficiency for this kind of thing is even lower, just to bring this back to reality a little bit. So for a fossil fuel plant, you're gonna get a spectrum of something like 0.38 to even as high as 0.6 for a combined cycle natural gas plant, whereas for a nuclear plant, it might be something like 30% to 35%. So if you are like a popular science kind of dork or anything like that, watch the Science Channel or anything, you'll see a lot of stuff on high temperature nuclear reactors. And to do that, they want to have like molten salt cooling, and so there's all sorts of complications with that, but there's a lot of effort going into high temperature reactors because you can bump up this sort of top level efficiency. So let's try something else. Now let's say that the cooling source is equal to 10 degrees C. We're gonna say it's like seawater or something, although this is pretty cold for seawater. So now, let's call this C. And we'll use the fossil fuel temperature. So we got 1 minus, now we got like 283 over 1673. We're going to get 0.83. So compare A and C to each other, you get about a 1% temperature, 1% efficiency boost by going from having a 10 degree heat sink versus a 25 degree heat sink. Let's do a little calculation to figure out how valuable 1 percentage point of efficiency is for operating a power plant. All right, let's say W dot electric is equal to 1,000 megawatts. Okay, and what we want to find is the fuel consumption, because that's like our biggest cost for operating. And we're just going to call this Q dot F. How do we get Q dot F in terms of W electricity? Well, we're going to have to say Q dot F, just like we knew how to go from efficiency, use it. Basically, we're flipping around the efficiency equation. So let's say our first efficiency
is equal to 0.38. So this is going to be equal to 1,000 megajoules per second over 0.38. Do some conversions. We've got this plant. Let's say this plant is operating 8,500 hours a year. So we've got 8,500. Hours per year. We've got 3,600 seconds an hour. This is going to give us 8.05 megajoules per times 10 to the 10 megajoules per year. Y'all see that? It's kind of inside. Let's call this QF1. And this will be A to 1. So what if we say A to 2 is equal to 0.39? Just bump it up by 1%. So if we replace this 0.38 with 0.39, we're going to get a fuel consumption of 7.85. times 10 to the 10 megajoules per year. So that's good. We want to decrease the amount of fuel we're buying for getting the same amount of electricity production. So this is a difference in about 0.2 times 10 to the 10 megajoules. So that's about equal, so we'll say zero change in Q equals about 0.2 times 10 to the 10 megajoules per year. That's about equal to 21 times 10 to the 6 million BTUs per year. If we say fuel costs $31 per million BTU, then that's a difference in $16.3 million per year. Pretty big difference.
Big difference for us, not a big difference for, you know, big power companies.
Sure, sure. And that might actually be 6.3 million. I copied this down earlier. Someone check that math real quick. 21 times 31. Times 10 to the 6. What do we got? Anyone with a calculator? That's really the last thing in class. If we can figure that out, then you guys are good to go. So I think 6.3.
21,
yeah, because 21 times 31 is going to have a 6 in front of it. So I think that's probably right. 6.51, yeah, close enough. All right, that's all I got. Any questions, feel free to figure out. Yeah, whatever.